know what to say to someone like, oh, I'm upset.
How would you feel if your innovation had ended up in a little video like that? Yeah? Well, I'm here to kind of talk to you today. I'm wearing a bit of a funny outfit because I'm actually looking for people to join the crew, essentially. What I believe is that that kind of thing is inevitable when you're doing something difficult and when you're innovating. Okay? People, there are always problems that people have to resolve. And there are always things like this that are unexpected that will occur. And I don't know if anyone has ever kind of seen this. Has anyone ever seen that before? So this is Ernest Shackleton. He was looking for crew back in the early 1900s. What he said, for a hazardous journey, small wages, bitter cold, long months of complete darkness, constant danger, safe return doubtful, honour and recognition in case of success. How many people do you reckon put their hand up for that kind of thing? Well, he got a full crew, right? He got a full crew, and he took them off to the South Pole. So basically what I'm going to try and talk to you about is whether that, I believe entrepreneurs and entrepreneurship is much like it being an explorer. It's difficult, it's hard, you will go through tragedy, success, failure, all sorts of things. But what will sustain you if you are doing something worthwhile is that working, you should work on something that has some meaning, some why for you, because otherwise you'll give up. So Matthew Flinders is a pretty famous guy, actually named Australia. Who was he? Why do people remember him? He was working on extremely incomplete information. Look at that map from that time. Who would know the east coast of Australia? You know, most of Papua New Guinea is kind of connected to Cape York. Right? These guys confidently sailed off to the other side of the world with that kind of information, so that they could do things like this to map Australia. Great things. But it was during those journeys they did amazing things. So he used a chronometer, which was invented 40 years earlier by John Harrison. He discovered that changes in barometric pressure precede the change in the wind. And he also invented what they call now the Flinders bars to correct magnetic deviation or variation in a boat alongside an animal. So I think the innovation occurs because of the journey, because someone's trying to do something amazing, not because people kind of sat around and thought about it one day. How about this guy? Recently said to the world, I'm going to put 1 million people on Mars and colonize that place in the next 30 to 50 years. It's pretty big ask, right? It's not his first hurrah, right? PayPal, SpaceX, Tesla, Elon Musk. 1 million people on Mars, big thing. And then once we've hit Mars, then why not check out the rest of the galaxy? Yeah. So there's a fantastic article on a blog site called Wake Up Why. It talks a little bit about how Elon Musk thinks. First thing it says is that you need to start with first principle. And if you could just kind of get rid of it. Don't get stuck in dogma, and I think that's probably a difficult thing for a lot of people. So what he does, and this is a pun, he said, he's thinking about rockets, and he's thinking about how to get people up into space, because that'd be an interesting thing to do. Historically, all rockets have been expensive, therefore all rockets will be expensive in the future, is the dogma. He talks to some people, and he discovers that actually, the whole price of a rocket, the stuff that goes into a rocket, is only 2% of the total cost. That's pretty extraordinary. So therefore, he sort of starts with a few more people on Saturdays, and he discovers that, in fact, there didn't seem to be any reason for that extra 98%, except the bureaucracy and the whole NASA organization. So he started SpaceX. How many rockets did he crash in the end? Like two or three or something like that before he got a successful one? So he started with first principles, understood the science, and he then believed that something was possible. He then also doesn't suffer from what most people suffer from, which is what everyone else thinks is probably right. So there's the, was it the emperor with no clothes there, right? So he's kind of like this little kid. So he's got the clarity of thought to not only understand it from first principle, but he's also got the confidence to tell people what he thinks. But most importantly, he confidently operates in what this article calls the chef lab in the world of 24/7. So one, not dangerous at all, 10, crazy, shouldn't do it. Most people, he said in this article, between 1 and 7, things aren't actually dangerous. But people believe that the things between 1 and 4 is really the only space that they are comfortable, happy to operate in. These floors of the world operate in the 5 to 7 space. And they operate there confidently because they've done it over and over again. They started off sailing little boats, and that was that became a little bit boring. So they went off across the English Channel. And once they come back from the Channel, they went off to the other side of the world. They did it piece by piece. They got used to taking risks and realizing that actually most of the time they didn't die. So Winston Churchill said, success is going from failure to failure without losing enthusiasm. And I think, I don't know about you guys, but innovation and being an entrepreneur is a lot like that. So this is the three part of the summary. So be humbler about what you know, so use science. Be more confident about what is possible, don't listen to what everyone else thinks because mostly they'll be wrong. And be less afraid of things that don't matter so they actually have the balls to do something that does. So I'll tell you a little bit about what we do at Fusion. We'll be a moment of time. So we believe that there's way too much waste in this world, but that kind of thing is unacceptable. We also believe that successful organisations are built by people like you guys making commitments to each other and then delivering on them every day. That's what Agile is all about. It's why people stand in front, it's why you get married in public. But whiteboards, spreadsheets, pieces of paper stand in the way of people doing that reliably every day in large organisations. And this kind of stuff is really typical, probably, of all your projects, right? And tools, post-it notes, normalising. So the problem is, if you're looking from long term down to where work gets done at the shift level, across all these different suites of things, the supervisor is separated from the intentions of their boss by all of this paperwork and spreadsheets and whiteboards and agile projects and lean and Six Sigma and this and that, right? And even though we've spent billions of dollars on ERPs, it doesn't hit the front line, and that creates waste and loss and poor productivity, and it actually means that the chain is broken in most cases. So we believe, and we've got this out of Gartner, that as work variability increases, the adaptability of the planning tools needs to increase as well, and at the moment, that's not the case. So right out here in the world of war, planning tools are far more effective. People understand that no plan stands first contact with the enemy. So they adapt, they're able to adapt, they're giving authority to adapt. Down here in manufacturing, where you expect your inputs and outputs to be reliable and sure. Somewhere in the middle, things fall apart because we don't have the kind of tools, we don't have the kind of culture that's necessary in order to drive real projects which are variable and not behaving the way we expect. So the result is waste, lost production, and incidents. Andy Green, we have a lot of conversations with Andy, and he says 90% of injuries occur in most workplaces as a result of people not following the plan. So if you think about that for a moment, if you could do one thing tomorrow, give people in your workplace a plan to take to work, you would reduce the number of incidents in that workplace. But I don't mean a Gantt chart. What are we going to do today? Well, for that. So we think you need a commitment system, and that's what Fusion is. That pulls together all of that work into one place, on a tablet, on a computer. Everybody's on the same page. It's easy. People know what they're going to do tomorrow. They know what they're doing today. They know what they're going to do next week. So you get situations like this. there's some people standing around a screen talking about the plan. And that results in massive increases in production and productivity for organizations. You have continuous improvement because you actually have a plan, you can do plan, do, check, act. People get all on the same page, you can contribute to the plan from the field, and you can see how the plan is tracking throughout the day. It's easy for supervisors to use. Everybody can see it in the workplace, so they know what's coming up and they know how to get prepared for tomorrow. Get reports every morning so you don't have to go running around looking for things. And we've just built this new tool which shows you where all the geotechnical hazards, are on site versus the people and equipment at work, so you can keep people safe. Ending up with 70% more work being planned each shift, and that's resulting in projects like that, $100 million under budget 7 months earlier for open, and 34% increase in development meters at one of our clean pool sites as a result of just being a whole lot more organized than what we've got. So people on sites are saying nothing happens if it's not infusion. Well, that makes us happy because that means that they're confident that they can get all of the sources of work into one place and they can manage people safely. Okay, so who wants to be a startup anyway? Who wants to be an entrepreneur? Anyone kind of had thoughts of that? Yeah? One? Okay. Well, you know, anyone heard about the valley of death? So what happens to ideas? Where do good ideas go apart from committees to die? So this is a journey. So I don't know if you guys heard about Simpro. I've got some friends of ours. They had a $40 million raise quite recently. $120 million valuation. Been around for about 17 years, they've done pretty well. Lassie did a $300 million raise not that long ago. People kind of talk about these guys as they're like overnight successes, but they're not, right? The people that traveled this journey have had many, many heartaches. They've thought about whether they can pay their guys this week or not. They've thought about whether all of their customers were going to disappear to a competitor. They've struggled. They've done the hard yards and they've kept on going. There's a fantastic book by Viktor Frankl. Anyone heard this book before? He wrote Man's Search for Meaning. And what he said is that he who knows the why, so he went through Auschwitz and came through as a psychiatrist and wrote this book as well. But his theory was people that know their why will put up with almost any how in order to survive. So point today is that if you're going to work on something like a startup or an innovation of any sort, work on something that matters to you because it has some large why that will drag you through when times are tough rather than kind of working on plans. Because these guys are all doing something that matters. Right? Go to Mars. Go to the other side of the world. Set up a new colony, get to the South Pole. And that's the kind of thing that leads their team and that keeps them going when times are tough. And they don't ask these kind of questions, right? You ever hear these questions about your innovation projects? Yeah? What do you think that does? Do you think that Captain Cook stood there in front of a group of people and said, "Do you know what? I know I can find kangaroos when I get to Australia." A black swan back in on looks like bullshit to us. But it wasn't, Can you prove your case and back it up and are you meeting your milestones? Those things kill innovation. The question is entrepreneurs and explorers ask, why does this have to be done by me now? Why would I go to the other side of the world? How much can I afford to lose on this? How long will I keep going when things get tough? What are we going to learn? So they went to a botanist with them to draw nice pictures of kangaroos. What did? Or how are we going to change the world? Those are things that drive people in times of trouble. So I will put to you that most of the great innovations of our time happen at the tip of that. Do you agree? Yeah? Sometimes they filter back down to everybody else. But there aren't that many people that appeared to be on the first ship to Mars. Right? There probably aren't that many people who have appeared, and maybe that was why Fresh came sort of came in, to be on the first ship to the New World, capital probably. But yet people did, right? So I think the challenge for you guys, and what the reason I'm dressed up like this, you know, is to try to find people in this room or in this building or in this government that would be the kind of people that would get on it. And maybe it's somehow stumbled into government by accident, got a job and got comfortable. But would be happy to get on that kind of boat. Because it's really hard to be an entrepreneur, but I think it's probably even harder to get anything worthwhile done in government. Sorry. Like something big. Because it is hard, right? I mean, how many of you guys have struggled with projects? Yeah? Sounds like it's going to happen. There's this new funding, you know, where you can get this funding to start all sorts of stuff. It's great. And she's still kind of doesn't make that happen, right? So, we need people that have the fortitude and the passion and the enthusiasm to actually be the seeds that we can plant our ideas into. If you're not going to be that kind of brave adventurer, then it's not going to work. Right? So we need to talk to you guys. We need people that are going to put up with that kind of drama, the potential of some